Welcome to our seminar on modern hop field networks. I'm Michael Kopp. One of the definitions in the Oxford English Dictionary of a pioneer is someone who opens up new areas of thought, research, or development. Sepp Hochreiter, our speaker today, is not only a pioneer of modern machine learning in this very sense, but someone who for the last 30 years has continued to shape this nascent field through countless innovations. In his master thesis, he identified the vanishing and exploding gradient problem, and later LSDMs were developed by him and Jürgen Schmidhuber to counter this effect. Sepp's work boasts contributions in nearly every area that makes up deep learning today. A small sample from recent years includes rectified factor networks, an unsupervised technique that learns a nonlinear high-dimensional representation of its inputs, rather a reward redistribution algorithm capable of being employed by most existing reinforcement learning algorithms, self-normalizing networks boasting the Sello activations, which a recent blog describes as make feed-forward networks great again, and today's topic, the introduction of modern continuous hop field networks. Like few others, he brings rigorous mathematical reasoning into deep learning, combining it with a deep intuition about how these algorithms work. Therefore, his insights have stood the test of time. He has received countless awards. The latest amongst them is this year's IEEE Neural Network Pioneer Award. Impressively, at least for me, as a Bavarian, he also managed to become Austrian of the Year in 2018. I'm proud of him being a fellow director at IRE. He's heading the Linz Institute of Technology AI Lab, and he is a professor at the Johannes Kepler University in Linz. Firstly, we will play a pre-recorded talk of Sepp's on hop field networks, in which we feel he outlined the subject at hand nicely. Then we will append a live Q&A session. But before we start, I yield the floor to Sepp for some introductory remarks.
Hi, everybody. Welcome here at the IRI. As Michael already told, I'm one of the directors of ERI. Thanks for the kind introduction, Michael. It was an honor to listen to all of that. Today, I want to go into research we are doing at ERI, basic research, advancing AI, advancing deep learning, and here the new ideas to include associative memories in deep learning architectures. And believe me, it's very successful. Enjoy the talk, it's a pre-recorded talk, but I will be around after the talk for a Q&A. Enjoy.
Thank you for joining my talk on modern hop field networks. Modern hop field networks introduce a new paradigm. We want to integrate associative memories into deep learning architectures. This is a standard deep learning architecture. Either you have a vector here, or you have a set of vectors, then you propagate this vector, set of vectors, you get a vector here, or you get the set of vectors here, you propagate it through the deep neural network, get a set of vectors, or a single vector here, the set of vectors can be summarized at the output layer, or you have an output vector. That's a standard deep learning idea. But we want to add to each of the layers of the deep neural network and associative memory. Therefore, deep learning goes beyond convolutional neural networks or beyond recurrent neural networks and allows for attention, memories, and point sets. We want to integrate modern hop field networks into the layers of deep learning architectures in order to allow for association of two sets, pattern search in sets, pooling operations, memories like LSTMs or gated recurrent units, vector quantization, transformer attention, sequence-to-sequence learning, point set operations, multiple instance learning, support vector machines in each layer, k-nearest neighbors in each layer, or learning vector quantization. What are modern hop field networks? Modern hop field networks were introduced by the seminal paper of Krotov and Hopfield in 2016, and they were generalized by Demirdi Zigil in 2017. These modern Hopfield networks tremendously increase the storage capacity compared to classical or standard Hopfield networks, and they converge extremely fast. Standard Hopfield networks are associative memories and associative memories date back to the 60s or 70s. And the Hopfield networks were then popularized by John Hopfield in 1982. The standard Hopfield networks, according to Hopfield 1982, there we have n binary patterns, x1 to xn, and each of the pattern is a d-dimensional vector, and the components of the vector are either minus 1 or plus 1. These patterns are stored in a weight matrix W, and the storage is done via a Hopf rule. You just do the sum of outer products of the patterns. And so you construct this weight matrix, and then you have a query pattern which should retrieve one of the stored patterns. The query pattern is also a d-dimensional vector with components either minus 1 or plus 1. And with this query pattern, you do an update, iterative update, where the state pattern is multiplied by the weight matrix W, then a constant vector is subtracted, and then the sign is taken. Actually, it's 2 times sine minus 1 to get again a vector with components minus 1 and plus 1. And this update rule minimizes the energy function. This is the energy function, and this energy function can be written like that. Here, interesting is this part, because it's the dot product between the state pattern xi and some pattern xi, and this dot product is squared. And we sum over all patterns. Then we have a linear term, but this one is not so important. Standard Hopfield networks can do that. We have Homer, image of Homer. We mask out part of the image, and then we can retrieve the image again. We can even store more patterns. We mask out Homer, that's Xi, and then we retrieve something. But now it didn't work. We get a complementary pattern. Or here we store 3 patterns, but we store 2 times mod, and if we have this Xi, then we retrieve mod, because this image of mod is dominant. It's multiple times stored in the weight matrix, and therefore we retrieve this dominant pattern. If you store more pattern, what often happens, this is again Xi, we retrieve some average. This is an average of all this pattern. For example, if you look here, this part, you will see again here, meaning this is some kind of average of all the patterns we have stored. It's a spurious minima. It's not what we want to have. We want to retrieve Homer. Standard Hopfield networks, according to Hopfield, here's a diagonal of the weight matrix W, is set to 0, has a linear storage capacity. Without errors, it's D divided by log D, forget about log D. D is the dimension of the patterns, it's the length of the patterns. Or if you allow small retrieval errors, it's 0.14 times D, meaning the storage capacity is linear, is D. This changes with modern Hopfield networks. Modern Hopfield networks, as introduced by Krotov and Hopfield in 2016. Here in the energy function, we have some F. If we remember, this was here sum for classical Hopfield networks of the dot product squared. Now it's F of the dot product. Again, we have the dot product between the state pattern and a stored pattern. And now this F can be a polynomial function. For A equals 2, we get back again the classical Hopfield network, but we can also use A equals 3 or A equals 10, and then we get a different dynamic. Energy minimization is done differently. Here, this is an update rule for component J of Xi. This updates component J of the state pattern Xi, and we compare 2 energies. That's an energy, and that's an energy, and this is energy, if you look here, for Xi J equals 1, or EB of Xi J equals 1. And this is as energy for Xi J equals minus 1, or EB of Xi J equals minus 1. And then we choose either minus 1 for Xi J or plus 1, depending where the energy is smaller. And that's the update rule. We just try out Xi for plus 1, Xi for minus 1 at the component J and takes a smaller energy, or takes this Xi with a smaller energy. Modern Hopfield networks with this polynomial interaction function has polynomial storage capacity. You see it here, it's d to a minus 1, for a equals 2, it's d, for a equals 5, it's d to the power 4. We also divide by log d, but this is a minor factor. Also, this was without errors, but if we allow small retrieval errors, it's also polynomial in d, d is the dimension of the vector of the patterns. These modern Hopfield networks of Krotov and Hopfield were generalized by Demir-Dezigil in 2017. And he is using the exponential function instead of the polynomial function. And this is a sum of exponentials of dot products between state patterns and stored patterns. And then he gets an exponential storage capacity in D. D is the dimension of the space where the patterns live. This is exponential storage capacity. And also what we get is a convergence of the update rule or retrieval after just one update. This is here by this theorem. We have this pattern that's like Xi. We have X tilde I, and it's close to the stored pattern Xi. And then the theorem says, for every pattern I and for every component J, if we update component J of this state pattern, then that the update is not equal to the stored pattern at this component J goes to zero. Meaning it's very likely, there's a high probability that after one update, we already have the correct component J. Here, modern Hopfield networks are working. Remember, it's always binary Hopfield networks. We store for the classical Hopfield network these patterns. So they're highly correlated, and we get this average spurious state retrieved. But for the modern binary Hopfield networks, we get Homer quite good retrieved. There's no retrieval error. Even if we store many more patterns, and they are highly correlated, and for Xi, we give in again, Homer masked out, we perfectly can retrieve Homer, and this even works for thousands or even for millions of patterns. These modern Hopfield networks work quite well. However, these modern Hopfield networks are binary. So binary, but I want to remind you, the goal was to integrate the modern Hopfield network into deep learning architectures. We want to bring them into deep learning architectures. But still, we want to learn this deep neural network by gradient descent. To apply gradient descent, we have to ensure that these networks are differentiable or continuous differentiable. Towards this end, we need continuous Hopfield networks, not binary Hopfield networks. Binary Hopfield networks would not be differentiable. We have to generalize the binary modern Hopfield networks to continuous Hopfield networks. We still want to keep retrieval after one update, because retrieval after one update means that we can just activate a layer. Whether it's a retrieval or activation of a layer, it's the same. Then activation of the layer is the same as a retrieval. And also we want to keep the high storage capacity, because we want to tackle a complex a task where a lot of data is generated. For constructing the new energy function, we assume n patterns to store, but now these patterns are from a d-dimensional space as before, but it's a real space. All components are real numbers. We glue these patterns to a pattern matrix. We have the pattern matrix X. M indicates the largest pattern, the length of the largest pattern. We also have a query pattern Xi. It's also a d-dimensional vector, but now it's a real vector. It's a vector containing of real values. And for defining the energy function, we need a function. And this is the log sum exponential function. And this is if you have a vector A with A1 to AN, then the log sum exponential is the exponential of all these A's multiplied by beta here, summed up, and the log of the sum. And we have a four-factor beta to the minus one. This is the log sum exponential. With the log sum exponential, we now can define the new energy function for continuous modern Hopfield networks. We have here the LSE plus a quadratic term in Xi. So LSE is already known from the binary Hopfield network of de Muri-Ziegel because we can write this energy function as the exponential of the LSE. We just remove the exponential here and then we have our energy function, but we also have to add this quadratic term. But because of the LSE, the properties of the binary modern Hopfield networks are kept. The property of exponential storage capacity and the property that we can retrieve the pattern after one update. Here are some constants, but the constants only ensure that the energy is lower bounded by zero and is upper bounded. The new energy function comes also with the new update rule. So new update rule for continuous modern Hopfield networks looks like this. The new state pattern is the old state pattern multiplied by all stored patterns. That's Xi transposed Xi, all these dot products. That's the vector of dot products. Then multiplied by beta. The softmax applied to this vector of dot products. And then the stored pattern matrix times the softmax. It's like an averaging over the stored pattern. You can have an average 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. Then you retrieve only pattern number 2. But if you have for the softmax other values, then you have some average over all stored patterns. This new update rule is supposed to minimize the energy. And here, this theorem shows that indeed the new update rule is minimizing the energy, and even more, the update rule converges to stationary points. In particular, it converges to a local minima. First of all, we see the update rule makes the energy minimal. The energy goes to an energy minimum. But even more, the energy goes to energy minima is already known by Sangwill's global convergence theorem. But we can show more. It's here that even the state pattern converges to a minimal pattern. Either it's a minimal pattern, or it converges to a submanifold of minima or a subspace of minima. But if the set of minimal points is finite, then this update rule converges to one of these finite points. And this iteration converges to really a minimum. Actually, it converges to stationary points, which might be local minima or settle points, but we never saw settle points. We always saw local minima, and we never saw that this update rule would not converge to a local minimum. The second property we want to have is a high storage capacity or exponential storage capacity. But for continuous pattern, we first have to define what do we mean by storing a pattern or what do we mean by retrieving a pattern. Because for binary, it's clear every component should be either plus one, minus one, should be the same. as the stored pattern. But here we have real numbers. If we very close to real number to the stored pattern, we also would classify this as yes being retrieved. And now we want to define storing and retrieving. We assume we have a stored pattern xi and a sphere around this stored pattern xi. And in this sphere, there's also a fixed point to which the update rule converges. And all points in the sphere converge to this fixed point. Also, xi converges to this fixed point in si. And if now all the spheres don't have any point in common, then we say the points xi are stored. And we say xi is retrieved if we have an iteration in our actual iteration state is epsilon close to the fixed point in si. Then a pattern xi is retrieved. The retrieval error is the difference between the state pattern where we stop the iteration and the stored pattern. Now we look to the exponential, to the storage capacity, which we show it's exponential. First of all, we assume that all patterns are on the sphere, all patterns are equally long. And then we assume patterns are randomly chosen. Because they are randomly chosen, we also have to introduce a failure probability that the patterns cannot be stored. And now we look at the storage capacity. We have a couple of parameters. This is the beta of the Hopfield network. K is defining the radius of the sphere. The radius of the sphere is m, but k is defining the radius of the sphere. Then we have the dimension in which the patterns live. And then we have this failure probability, how likely it is that nothing is working, that we cannot store it. And then we can show it's exponential in the dimension. Where we have to define a constant c, and c depends on all these parameters. For example, for these parameters, c is 3.1. It's like 3.1, and here we have d20, 19 over 4. That's the storage capacity we would get for these parameters. But we get differences for different dimensions and different other parameters. C is defined only by these parameters, and we get exponential storage capacity. And this holds if D is larger than the D given in this theorem, then it works also. We can always increase D and everything works. This is the minimal D we have to assume. The second very important property is retrieval with one update. We already defined retrieval. What is retrieval? The state pattern minus the fixed point should be smaller than epsilon. The state pattern is after one update, it's only the query xi, and also on this update rule f applied to this query pattern. After one update, this is given by f, it should be epsilon close already to the fixed point. And to define retrieval and retrieval with one update, we have to introduce a separation of a pattern. The separation of the pattern is given by delta i. Delta i is the dot product of a pattern with itself minus the maximal dot product of the pattern with some other pattern. Meaning, how similar is the pattern to itself and how similar is the pattern to some other pattern. And for well-separated pattern, meaning large delta i, the retrieval works with one update. It can be shown here. That is the difference between after one update, the difference to the fixed point. This should be smaller than epsilon. And here we have the original distance to the fixed point. And this is multiplied by this Jacobian. And this Jacobian is the exponential minus beta delta I times m. That's the radius And if the radius is large or beta is large, we can make the term very, very small, very, very negative. This part is normally very small. This doesn't count. It's Xi should be already close to the pattern, otherwise we would not retrieve the pattern. Also, the fixed point is close to the pattern. This is small. Delta is large, comparable. And delta is large if the patterns are separated. And then we can guarantee this, that after one update, the new data point Xi new is epsilon close to the fixed point for large enough separation and large enough delta and radius of the sphere. Also, the retrieval error decreases exponentially with the separation delta I. We have the same formula here. Now we have the pattern and not the fixed point. How close is the updates Xi new? How far it is away from the stored pattern? And again, we have exponential minus beta delta m here, and these terms are small compared to this exponential function. It's going to zero very, very fast, and also we have exponential small retrieval error, depending on the separation. For well-separated patterns, we know we can retrieve them with one update. But what happens if patterns are not well separated? Here we get metastable states. Let's assume some vectors are similar to each other. Similar to each other is given by the separation. The dot products is comparable high. But on the other hand, they are well separated from all other vectors. The dot product with other vectors is small. The dot product between them, it's high. Then we have a fixed point near the similar vectors, and this fixed point is a metastable state. If iterates start near this metastable state, the iterate converge to this metastable state. Even if we are on top of the similar patterns, if we are on top of these patterns, the iteration would converge to this metastable state. So metastable state is something which we want to have in many, many cases, because it's some average of the similar patterns. It's some prototype or cluster center of the similar patterns. And very often we want to have those metastable states because it gives us some kind of clustering, some kind of discretization. Here, these modern Hopfield networks, the continuous Hopfield networks tried out. We see here we have grayscales. Grayscales indicate here that we have continuous values. We stored many of these images. The images are highly correlated, but still we were able, even if Homer was masked out, so that's Xi J, for example, we can retrieve the pattern very or the image very, very precisely. But it depends on the beta. For small beta, like here, beta 0.25, we get some average. That's an average of all the patterns we have stored. And if we increase beta, then patterns which are similar to this state pattern, to this query pattern, get weighted up. And more, we see more and more Homer coming out of the fog. The fog is produced by all the patterns which also have contributed to the dot product. And at some point, because for large beta, we get very clearly out only the picture of Homer, which means the softmax has one at one position and zeros at all other positions. But for smaller beta, we have metastable states. Perhaps it's an average over five images, or it's an average over 20 image. But if increase beta, at some point, it's only one image, is an average over one image. The metastable states, that's in a two-dimensional space. First, for small beta, we have these patterns we have stored. For small beta, we have only one fixed point. It's the average of all the black dots. It's sitting in the middle. If increase beta, we get already two fixed points. These are metastable points. And so somehow divide the space into two regions. And if we first increase beta, we already get here four fixed points, and we see here the separation delta I is large, and therefore the fixed point sitting on top of a pattern, but here the separation is not so large, therefore the fixed point is not sitting on top of the pattern. But if we increase, we see now also this fixed point is sitting on top of a pattern, it's a well separation. Also the space is divided into four quadrants. Each quadrant is occupied by one of the fixed points. And if we increase, the quadrants are better separated. The fixed points are more and more sitting precisely on top of a pattern. And we get this case where we only retrieve these fixed points. Now, the very interesting and quite astonishing fact. Our new update rule we have defined is the attention as used by transformers. The transformer attention and our update rule is the same. This is a transformer attention. And if we do some algebraic reformulation of our update rule, we get exactly the transformer attention. This is the Hopfield energy as introduced by Demirezigil. This is our new energy function for continuous Hopfield networks. This energy function uses this update rule to go to the energy minimum. And we see this update rule is exactly the transformer attention if we do this algebraic reformulation. We have exactly the same formula. Now we have the new energy function and the modern continuous Hopfield networks. Everything is ready, but how should we integrate our continuous new Hopfield networks into a deep learning architecture? How to do it? And here we have three ways how to integrate this new Hopfield layers. We also introduced four layers, Hopfield, Hopfield pooling, and Hopfield layer. In the first case, we propagate two sets, R and Y. R as a queries and Y's as a stored patterns. And both the R and the Y's are coming from previous layer. It could be the previous layer, but also some layers below. Both come from previous layer and propagated through. And new results are stored in Y. New queries are generated via R. Or in Hopfield pooling, we only propagate the Y's, the stored patterns, through the network, while the queries are fixed or they are learned. But the queries do not depend on the new input data. The queries are always the same, even if we learn them. Only the Y is propagated through the network, comes from above, and here this goes perhaps to the new Y. The third case is the Hopfield layer. Here we propagate R. If we propagate R, it's somehow we only propagate the queries, but the Y's are fixed here. This Y is fixed. This could be, for example, the training data. Training data. We fix the training data and we use different queries to probe in every layer again and again the training data. And this result gives perhaps new queries to again probe the training data. There we can implement something like support vector machines or k-nearest neighbors. But for Hopfield pooling, if we put in the Y comes from our input, so we can do multiple instance learning, or this Y can be a sequence, and we can do something like LSTMs. This is the first layer, the layer Hopfield. We propagate both. Here we propagate from previous layers, both into R, into Y, and this allows us to implement stuff like transformer self-attention. sequence-to-sequence learning, point set operation, and all kind of retrieval-based methods. Also decoder, encoder attention, also attention to other modules, everything is allowed. R and Y are two sets coming from previous layers, depending somehow on the input to be processed. The second layer is the layer Hopfield pooling. Here, Y comes from previous layer, could be also directly the input, but is input dependent. But Q is not input dependent. Q is a fixed query. And what we can do pooling operation on Y. So Q defines the pooling operation. Or we can convolution operations. Q defines what kind of convolutions, especially if there's position encoding involved. We can do memories. So fixed queues somehow probe a sequence, somehow pull out some information out of sequences. Also something like LSTMs or gated recurrent units can be implemented in every layer of this deep neural network. The query is always fixed. It can be learned, but it does not change if you have a new input. And of course, you can do multiple instance learning. If you do here is instances, or what you can do here is a sequence. So your instances, your sequence, you can always put in. It depends on the input, because every new input has different instances, every new input has a different sequence, and you always probe it. The third layer we propose is the layer Hopfield layer. Here now, only the queries are propagated. This comes from previous layer, from the previous layer, or for some previous layer, but the things we are storing, they are fixed. What we are storing could be prototypes, cluster centers, templates, or reference. And what we can do here store is something like the training data. If there's a training data stored, then we can again and again probe the training data, and here we can produce a new query, a new R, and there we can do k nearest neighbor. Support vector machines, because here we can extract a support vector. Similarity-based methods, we can look for the most similar pattern in here, like also like k nearest neighbor, but we can generalize k nearest neighbor. Or learning vector quantization. All this kind of classical machine learning method can be implemented in each layer. Each layer has the training data available and can generate new probes, new similarity measures again and again. Experiments. Hopfield layers can be applied successfully to a wide range of tasks, to natural language processing, multiple instance learning, for small classification tasks or drug design problems. For the first set of experiments, it's about natural language processing. We know already transformers or BERT models work very well, but we also know they are modern Hopfield networks. Therefore, we know modern Hopfield networks work very well for natural language processing. I don't have to go into that. The second set of experiments is multiple instance learning. The modern Hopfield network give you a memory, and you can keep the instances of your object you want to classify into in the memory. And we use here Hopfield pooling to do that. For experiments, we show it on immune repertoire classification and some standard multiple instance learning benchmark data sets. For immune repertoire classification, the task is you have a person and you extract some immune cells from these persons, sequence the immune cells and look whether this person is immune against a certain disease. Think about COVID. We want to know, is somebody immune against COVID or not? We extract some cells, sequence it, and some of the cells contains a pattern which shows this person is immune against COVID-19. And therefore, there are a few patterns which show whether this person is immune or not. but we have a large set of sequences. And only few patterns are indicative. And in this case, we have about 300,000 instances, 300,000 different cells, and each of the cells can give you information about the immune status of this person. Therefore, this is one of the largest multiple instance learning tasks ever conducted, and many multiple instance learning methods fail because the large number of instances. We did some experiments with different methods. Here is our method, support vector machine, k-nearest neighbor, and different methods which were designed for multiple instance learning. And our method works best, outperformed everything else, in real-world data set. That's the real world. We also did some experiments where we implanted some signals into real-world data, or we generated data by LSTMs, or we simulated data by other methods. But most important is, of course, the real world. And there, Hopfield pooling outperformed all competitors, outperformed all other methods, even on the simulated data. Now to multiple instance learning, benchmark data sets, known data sets. They are images. Here's images of elephants, foxes, or tigers. You have to classify, is there an elephant or a fox on the image or not? And the images are divided into patches. You have 1,300 or 1,400 patches about. And depending on the patches, you have to classify it. And now we do each of the patch we store in our memory, in our modern Hopfield network, and try to classify it. The UCSB breast cancer classification is also an image. It's a histopathological image, and you should classify whether it's cancerous or it's normal, whether it's diseased or not. You have about 2,000 instances, and you want to classify that. And it turns out, our Hopfield network gets a new state of the art in 3 out of 4 of these standard benchmark data sets. That's really a very cool result and shows how good these new methods work. The next set of experiments is on small data set of the UCI benchmark collections. What is known is deep learning does not work well with small data set. But this changes with modern Hopfield networks, that's not longer true, because you can store the whole training data in your Hopfield network and always probe it, always check it. We, of the 121 UCI data sets, we selected the 75 smallest data sets, which are the data sets which have less than 1,000 samples. And then we compared all these methods. These are method groups. There are different support vector machine, different random forest implementations, and boosting, logistic regression, nearest neighbor, decision trees, and also, of course, our modern Hopfield networks with the layer Hopfield. And it turns out that our Hopfield network is better than all other methods, outperformed all others, and even in 10 data sets, it has a new state of the art. This deep learning techniques is better on small data set than all competitors, than better than support vector machine, random forest, and so forth. Our last set of experiments is on drug design. There are 4 drug design categories, data sets, either new antivirals, new protein inhibitors like human beta secretase, or metabolic effects, something like Sublain, a blood-brain barrier, or side effects. Does a drug candidate have a side effect? And we compared, of course, our Hopfield network with the Hopfield layer, support vector machine, extreme gradient boost and XG boost, random forest, and all kind of deep neural networks, but also graph neural networks, because graph neural networks were recently shown to perform very well on molecules. And it turned out, in 2 out of the 4 benchmark data sets, we have a new state of the art. And for the other 2, we perform very well. Again, Hopfield networks were the best on this data set, outperformed support vector machine, XGBoost, random forest, and all kind of graph neural networks. Summarizing, We want to integrate associative memories into deep learning architectures. We bring in some memories. It's up to the user what this why is, where it comes from previous layer, from externally, from a database. And this new architectures allows attention, memory, vector quantization, set association. In every layer, you can implement a support vector machine, a k-nearest neighbor, learning vector quantization, some pattern search, or extracting templates. To get more information on modern Hopfield networks, we have a blog here. We also have a software. Check out the software. We have also a paper on archive. And there's also a video of Yannick Kilcher. Thank you for your attention and interest in my talk. Have fun with modern Hopfield network. Try it out. You get new state of the art. I promise you.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much, Sepp. That was a great video, I have to say. Sepp, before I go into the questions which are starting to come in, one question for you. Any latest updates, any results that you guys have come up with where you use modern Hopfield networks?
Yes, indeed. I showed a couple of applications, but it took up more speed as this technique. Right now, there's a paper already out in archive. This is for drug design. For drug design, what's important task is synthesis. I have a compound, but how do I build it? How do I construct it? What are the chemical reactions for building this? And here we have fantastic results because we had a system where the chemical reactions were stored in this Hopfield layer, And as input, I get a compound, and the compound said which chemical reaction would be appropriate to produce this compound. And the other pharma companies couldn't believe it, said we are so good. We were even good in a zero-shot learning, meaning yes, this chemical reaction was never used in the training set. We don't know it, but only by describing it and seeing similarities of the compound to the description of the chemical reaction years ago. And this is now a very hot topic in pharma companies because most of the chemical reactions were never used, you know, they exist, but they were never used to really build an actual compound. It's a modern Hopfield network blew away all other methods in this domain, which is nice. And here you see, the idea was, what do I store in this memory? And I can store symbolic things. I can store knowledge. And I have an associative way to get access to this knowledge. And this opens a door to a rich plethora of new algorithms. That was one. Another new topic we tackled, we already did a little bit the UCI data set and stuff like this, but we extended this and now we have complete new results on tackling small data sets, which is called tabular data, methods for tabular data. Also here, it's not out right now. We have the results are coming in right now, but here we see many data sets that we can beat XGBoost, random forest support vector machines. But this is research going on, but we are totally optimistic that here also we will get very, very cool and great results.
That's fascinating. I mean, and it's a thriving industry. Actually, maybe one question from Louise. With respect to small data sets, by saying that Hopfield networks work with small data sets, is it because they are like storing the whole data set? And would it be like overfitting on the data? Or what am I missing?
That's a very good question, because that's exactly what's happening. First of all, yes, we are storing the training data set together with the labels. Perhaps if a representation of some, we learn a good representation. And the biggest problem is really overfitting. That's true. But you can do something like a dropout. You can do what we are playing around with is memory dropouts. And your data set is smaller. We can also do feature dropouts and your data is represented in a different way because one feature is missing. And if you do all this kind of dropout stuff, then overfitting is reduced. and you get good results. But we are still exploring this. Also, the embedding dimension should be a long vector should be embedded in a small dimensional space. We have many things to explore, but this dropout of features and dropout of samples, training samples in the Hopfield network looks good because it's somehow, again, like random forest where you also do this and you can build an ensemble. But there are many possibilities. But you're right. Overfitting is a problem, but we can tackle it.
Very nice. So let me go back to some questions that were asked at the start. The first one came in from Fala, and I think he was wondering about the role of the softmax in the update. And he was wondering why not use essentially just in each component a sigmoid or something like that.
So softmax. This update rule can be proven if you do it iteratively to converge to a local minimum. One of the ingredients we need is the derivative of the LSE is the softmax. That's how we can show it. We need this in the proof, in the CCCP, kind of proof, concave, convex optimization. And here we need exactly the softmax property. If we would do something like sigmoid, it could be an idea, but we don't have proof of convergence. We lose all this mathematical background of the softmax. And also we would lose this nice connection to transformers and other methods. Therefore, sigmoid would be possible, but we lose also mathematical ground.
Very good answer. Actually, a question from Dima Krotov. When you discuss the capacity of the model with softmax, there's a constant C, which seems to depend on D. Does this mean that the dependence of the memory storage capacity on D is more complicated than just exponential? What would be the limiting behavior of the capacity for the model with a softmax as D grows to infinity?
I didn't look into this, but it's correct. The C, the small C I used there, it's computed by some formula, and really D also enters the C, but in a good way. If it's larger D, you get larger C. There's a dependence is more complicated, but to be honest, I never computed the limit of D to infinity, but I will do it. I will give you the result.
Fantastic. Brilliant. So my question would be, and I think I'm part of that industry. I mean, you alluded to it, but any kind of applications where you can reuse features inside a network. I mean, if I think of even the thing you presented, that comes very close to, I believe it's the perceiver architecture, where sort of in a transformer, the input data is kind of reused. Is that a very similar idea to the idea that you had?
Yes, it's a transformer update. It's version one, where it's the same as a transformer, where both what the store is input dependent and also the query is input dependent. Then you combine and connect somehow different input components, like in language it would be words, or you have a different set elements. But you can do more. And this was overlooked, I think, as we did with the chemical reactions. You can put into the Hopfield networks any kind of external information, symbolic information, whatever, and then try to embed it in some space. And then try to get accessed by association. And then you can go ahead to transform as a symbolic thing, which you have to convert into a vector again and work with it. But you can integrate very easily, as we did with the chemical reactions, knowledge, human knowledge, into neural networks and work with this. And the other thing is really, you can again and again access your original data, like your original training data, or whatever you want to put in, your reference data or whatever. You hold it in every layer as a reference, as a where you can compare your current status with things you already have achieved or which you're familiar with. And there's much more ideas you can do than only this transformer. So transformer is only the tip of the iceberg.
Maybe one last question. On the small sort of small data sets with small patterns, you mentioned dropout and other things. What role does the beta play? Does it is it something that needs to be fine-tuned, or is there a canonical one where you find that that works?
We are not there. It's a paper we did. We played around with it and then it was fixed. Right now, we are exploring different kind of beta and even exploring that beta is learnable, that it can adjust itself. But to be honest, we are not there. We use some fixed beta, which is, I think, because there are so many other knobs you can turn around and get good performance. And for the first thing, for the new data sets, we couldn't believe that we have the good performance because, but we do not understand everything. This was the first experiments at UCI, but we have now other, because there were other publications on Tableau data. We also looked into that. And there's many things in it, but like it was already mentioned, overfitting is a big issue. Because if you have all of your data points, you memorize them and then you're done. And but there are also many ways how to avoid that.
Fantastic. Well, Sepp, the time is up. Thank you very, very much indeed for an amazing presentation and talk. Thank you everyone for participating and the great questions. All I can say is for everyone who wants to do research, this is an incredible opportunity to jump on a new, very powerful technique, which, as you said, Sepp, we're only just scratching the surface. Thank you very much, everyone.
Also from my side, thank you. See you soon. See you at ERI. And let's together push forward this hopeful idea.
Fantastic. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.